Philip determined to go to Washington and see for himself. He had other reasons also. He began to know enough of Mr. Bolton's affairs to be uneasy. Pennybacker had been there several times during the winter, and he suspected that he was involving Mr. Bolton in some doubtful scheme. Pennybacker was in Washington, and Philip thought he might perhaps find out something about him and his plans that would be of service to Mr. Bolton. Philip had enjoyed his winter very well, for a man with his arm broken and his head smashed. With two such nurses as Ruth and Alice, illness seemed to him rather a nice holiday, and every moment of his convalescence had been precious and all too fleeting. With a young fellow of the habits of Philip, such injuries cannot be counted on to tarry long, even for the purpose of love-making, and Philip found himself getting strong with even disagreeable rapidity. During his first weeks of pain and weakness, Ruth was unceasing in her ministrations. She quietly took charge of him, and with a gentle firmness resisted all attempts of Alice or anyone else to share to any great extent the burden with her. She was clear, decisive, and peremptory in whatever she did, but often when Philip opened his eyes in those first days of suffering and found her standing by his bedside, he saw a look of tenderness in her anxious face that quickened his already feverish pulse, a look that remained in his heart long after he closed his eyes. Sometimes he felt her hand on his forehead and did not open his eyes for fear she would take it away. He watched for her coming to his chamber. He could distinguish her light footstep from all others. If this is what is meant by women practicing medicine, thought Philip to himself, I like it. Ruth, said he one day when he was getting to be quite himself,
I believe in it.
Believe in what?
Why, in women physicians.
Then I'd better call in Mrs. Dr. Longstreet.
Oh, no, one will do, one at a time. I think I should be well tomorrow if I thought I should never have any other.
The physician thinks thee mustn't talk, Philip, said Ruth, putting her finger on his lips.
But, Ruth, I want to tell you that I should wish I never got well if—
There, there, thee must not talk. Thee is wandering again. And Ruth closed his lips, with a smile on her own that broadened into a merry laugh as she ran away.
Philip was not weary, however, of making these attempts. He rather enjoyed it. But whenever he inclined to be sentimental, Ruth would cut him off with some such gravely conceived speech as,
"Does thee think that thy physician will take advantage of the condition of a man who is as weak as thee is? I will call Alice if thee has any dying confessions to make."